himself even as he is pure. That shows the kind of person we are. If whatever you have got now, a place in the world, position in the world, a place in the church, position in the church, a name in the world, a name in the church, if that's all you need and you've got it, you'll not think it's necessary to purify yourself. You'll say, what am I purifying myself for? I have what I have always wanted. But here it says, the people that have the hope of glory, the hope of heaven, and they want to spend eternity in heaven, every man without exception, because only the pure will reach there, only the holy will reach there, only the righteous will reach there. Every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. Heavenly citizenship will be there in Jesus' name. Give me a good amen. I'm dividing the message into three parts. Number one, passion and pursuit of the heavenly city. Passion and pursuit of the heavenly city. Number two, the promise and preparation for the heavenly country. Promise and preparation for the heavenly country. Number three, purity and perseverance. You need to persevere, endure till the very end. Hold on to the very end. Maintain the same commitment, the same consecration, the same devotion, and the same heart desire until the very end. Purity and perseverance of heavenly citizens. Number one, passion and pursuit of the heavenly city, for the heavenly city. We're looking at Psalm 27. Psalm 27, we're looking at verse 4. One thing have I desired of the Lord. It's the Psalm of David. The man had a name, the man had position, the man had some honor, the man had some servant soldiers, the man had some wealth, he had riches, he had prosperity, he had wife, he had children, he had houses, he had palaces. But then he said, one thing have I desired of the Lord, that and that will I seek after. He said, beyond and above everything I have got, there's one thing I'm seeking after, there's one thing I'm pursuing, there's one thing I'm passionate about. One thing have I desired of the Lord. You see, that's what makes the Christian life what it ought to be. Once you are derailed, once you are distracted, and you put another thing beyond this one thing, this desire to get to heaven, maybe riches, maybe having a husband, maybe having a wife, maybe having children, maybe having a job, maybe having a kind of title in the denomination, becoming a reverend, a bishop, an archbishop, a priest, a father. Once you put any other thing beyond the desire of getting to heaven, it's going to affect your faithfulness and obedience to the word. You'll not be conscious of who you are, where you are, what you're doing. But David said, with all I have got, one thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 19. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. Are there not people that their Christianity is only for this life? Are there not people that pray only for things of this life? Are there not people that are very, very religious and sanctimonious only because of the things of this life? Look at the millions of people in this our country, in this continent of Africa, that rush to a place of worship one day or the other and ask, why do they go there? Why do they rush there? And look at the thousands of people that come to our church. I need to ask the question, where do they come? What are you looking for? Is it only for the things of this world? And then when you pray, and you're praying for this or the things of this world, how do you pray so passionately and so fervently when it comes to thinking and preaching and hearing and preparing for heaven and praying for heaven? How do you pray? If in this world, in this life only, you have hope in Christ, you'll be of all men the most miserable. Because the Lord himself said in Mark chapter 8, Mark chapter 8, reading from verse 36, for what shall he profit a man if he shall gain the whole world? What will you do to gain something in this world? Maybe you want to gain money. What do to gain money? Maybe you want to gain promotion in your place of work. What do to gain promotion in the place of work? Maybe you want to have a certificate. After all, that certificate is going to be useless the day you die or you are buried. The certificates are not going to be buried with you. Even if they are buried with you, what's the use? What's the value? What do to get a certificate? Maybe some people, all they want is getting a wife. What do to get a wife? You know, people will do anything to get a wife. But the day you die, that wife will not be buried with you. What do you do to get a husband? Anything, anything. The people that forget their souls, they forget eternity, they forget holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. They will do anything. And the word of God is saying, what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world? Come back to the church here. What do to gain the position of a pastor? The privilege of a worker. And to hold your place so that nobody will ever be able to remove you or discipline you. What do? To keep that place of being a worker in the church. But how useful is that? What shall he profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? If there's anything well to seek, if there's anything well to run after, if there's anything well to pursue, it should be that we're ready and prepared for heaven. Paul the apostle knew that. That's why his passion, his pursuit, was to get there eventually. In Philippians chapter 1, Philippians chapter 1, I'm reading there from verse 21. Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. For me to live is Christ. It says, I wake up in the morning, I'm thinking, how can I follow Christ more intimately today? How can I speak like Christ, talk like Christ, act like Christ, think like Christ, behave like Christ, eat like Christ, and interact like Christ, love like Christ? How can I do something today just to be more intimate with Christ? For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. This was not a man afraid of death. If you know religious people, in fact, the reason why many people go to churches or run to churches, especially churches where they pray a lot. They are praying about heaven. They are praying so that you'll extend your place and your life here on earth, so that they will not die, so enemies will not catch them, so sickness will not kill them. What does it matter? If you live long on earth, you live in health, you live in wealth, but there's no salvation. For me to die is gain. But if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor. Yet, what as I choose, I wot not, I know not. For I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. That's the passion of a real apostle. Show me an apostle today. Many people that parade themselves, I'm apostle. Do they have this passion to go to heaven? This desire to go to heaven? Or is it just a title? Here it says, I'm in strait betwixt you. It's like there is kind of conflict here within me. I have a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. In verse 24, nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. I'm sure you know some people that they don't understand the scriptures. They don't understand the pursuit and the passion of a believer. And sometimes, you know, they want to kind of deceive you with their dreams and their visions. And they say, you know, come to our church because our prophet said, you know, there is a relative. And then as he described it, I knew he was describing you. And he said that that relative is going to die. And if he doesn't come, leave his church and come to our church, and we'll pray for him and anoint him with oil and give him deliverance, he will die. You know, that's the method they use for the people who don't know that death is glory. Like going home, going to heaven. There's nothing bad in going to heaven. And the apostle said, I want to go, but I'm going to stay for some time to minister unto you. Don't allow anybody to threaten you. But that thing they call death. They saw a vision, they had a dream, and somebody said, and then somebody comes to you and he says, are you so and so? Yes, I am. Huh. Be very careful. Don't go to the retreat. Don't go to a crusade. Don't go anywhere. There's some people waiting for you there. They're going to kill you. You know, this kind of thing that they use in the world right now. And they use that because you don't know, they know you don't understand that you have to have the passion and the desire of going to heaven. Jesus is there. Why would he not be there? In Philippians chapter 3, I'm reading there from verse 10, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. Then he says, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. That was his passion. That was his pursuit. A real child of God, that ought to be your passion. He says, that I may know him. And then he says, if I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I'd already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. He had a passion. He had a pursuit. He had a desire. And he wouldn't allow anything to discourage him or to turn him around. And if you're a real child of God, that ought to be your heart. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. I'm reading from verse 24. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all? But one receiveth the prize, so run that she may obtain. It says, there is a prize.